much, Anna. Good morning, everyone. It's a really great pleasure for me to be with you in the beautiful Barcelona today for this important gathering. The theme of this year's Global Sports Forum, Sports What Next, certainly asks the right question. Success in almost every endeavor, whether it's sport, business, politics, or science, depends on the being able to answer that question correctly. We live in an ever-changing world. Those who are able to anticipate and adapt to the future will always be far ahead of those who cling to the status quo. The question, what's next, is particularly relevant in these times. Change is occurring faster than ever in today's world. Globalization, advances in technology, demographical shifts, and other geopolitical factors are having a profound impact on society and, of course, on sport. Our challenge is to anticipate the future so we can use the power of sport to help shape it. That has been the mission of the Olympic movement since its founding in 1894. Our movement has thrived for more than a century by adapting to the changing times while remaining true to the timeless Olympic values, fair play, respect for competitors, and the pursuit of excellence. We have maintained our effectiveness and value-based organization by maintaining our relevance. I know that spirit of Juan Antonio Samaranch is with us today because he understood the link between effectiveness and relevance better than anyone. He brought the Olympic movement into the modern era. He gave developing nations more opportunities to participate by creating the Olympic Solidarity Program. He opened doors for women, both on the field of play and on the International Olympic Committee. He used television and sponsorship to reach global audience and strengthen the movement's financial foundation. He had keen appreciation for the role of sport in society at large. It is not at all surprising that Samaranch was early and avid supporter of this forum. And if he stay with us today, for sure he has some thoughts on what next for world of sport. One thing is clear, the world needs sport and Olympic values now more than ever. Physical inactivity and obesity rates are on the rise in countries around the world. The World Health Organization reports that obesity, one thought to be a problem only for the wealthy countries, has reached epidemic proportions in some parts of the developing world. Physical inactivity is a leading contributor to non-communicable diseases that account about 60% of all deaths worldwide. At the same time, sport faces increasing more competition for the time and attention of young people. So, what do we do about it? We have to find new ways to share the joys and benefit of sport with the world of youth. We have to be more creative and strengthen sport events and in communicating to the young people. Under the leadership of IOC President Jacques Roger, IOC has made both of those issues a top priority. Olympics and youth was one of the five major themes at the 13th Olympic Congress in 2009. The Congress highlighted the need of actively engage young people whenever and wherever we can, at school, at home, and online. The IOC put in that advice into the action. The first Youth Olympic Games in Singapore last August showed the benefits that can come from experimenting with new approaches. Half-court basketball turned out to be one of the most popular events on the program. Young athletes from around the world enjoy participating on the mixed gender teams and teams drawn from different countries. We have some interesting pairings. For example, an American and Cuban athlete become fast friends when they join forces on the modern pentathlon mixed relay team. We will see similar innovation approaches who win this sport and the first Winter Youth Olympic Games in general in Innsbruck. We also continue to refresh the programs for traditional Olympic Games. The addition of the existing new disciplines like BMX, snowboard, halfpipe, have helped keep the games relevant to the new generation of athletes and fans. Adjusting the sport program is important, but it's not enough. We have to make full use of information technology to attract and engage young people. Although it took a while to most of us to notice that rules of the games changed dramatically in February 2004, that a new website called Facebook was launched. Today, Facebook has more than 600 million members worldwide. And there are plenty of other ways to connect through social media, Babu, Arthur, the Class, the Twitter, and the list go on and on. They all have one thing in common, two-way communication. We can no longer simply deliver our message and consider our work done. We have to find the ways to engage in conversation with young people. It takes more effort, but the rewards are worth it. The IOC launched its Facebook page shortly before the Vancouver Winter Games. By the time the games were over, it had enlisted more than 1 million Olympic fans. There are now more than 3.5 million. By continually updating the site with interesting photos, videos, and interactive games and contests, IOC is gathering interest and promoting Olympic values between the games. It is using social media to leverage the power of sport. I have experience in power of sport in my own life. Sport opened doors for me, even when I live under restriction on the Soviet system. I opened more doors when I had joy competing under the Ukrainian flag. I would not have had the success I have had in life if not for sport. As leaders in the world of sport, we have obligation to see that other young people can have similar opportunities. It does not matter if they never attain on world record. They will be better off just by competing. So, as we begin this conference, I would like to make a request. Please keep the next generation in mind as we consider the question, what's next? Thank you. Gracias.